This session is going to be chaired by John Harris, and Patrick Heller is going to be the speaker. So I request both of them to please come, and John to start the proceedings.
Right. I have to say, I'm not quite sure why I'm doing this, but Aruna asked me, so I'm very happy to do it. I'm not going to offer a long introduction of Patrick. The bio data is there, and he's spoken already today. I'd just like to say that he's a very good friend, a scholar whom I greatly admire. He stands out for me amongst scholars who are have been pretty deeply into India, as having also studied in depth other great societies as well. Whereas so many of us who study India get very sort of stuck in our work in India and lack, I think, the comparative perspective which you, Patrick, now bring to your work. So over to you.
Thank you, John. And again, thank you to Aruna and the all organizers. I want to begin, especially in the last session, and including Aruna's intervention, some questions about defining democracy came up. So I just want to, I pulled together three quick quotes from three sociologists and two political scientists that I have written, I think, very important things about democracy. And I want to read these and then give you my minimalist definition and then move on into a discussion of the various dimensions of participatory democracy. So Theodore Scotchpole, famous sociologist, who's written on revolutions, among other things, and has also compared the current period of democracy in the United States to the period of the 40s through the 60s, and she argues that the problem with American democracy is that there's been a massive, there are no mass organizations left in the United States, none whatsoever, and so it's very much an elite democracy. But in any event, to Aruna's point, and a point many of you have been making, and I think it needs to be underscored, democracy is not a thing. It's a process. It's contested. It's ongoing. The day we stop talking about it, the one thing we can be sure of is that we no longer live in a democracy, right? And democracy, for all its faults, is the one system of governance, for want of a better word, that allows for its own reform. And I think that's quite critical. But as it is contested. It's the product of struggles, et cetera. Jonathan Fox, who's written a lot on the relationship between clientelism and democracy in the Mexican context, has this quote, which I want to read, because I think it underscores what, for me, is the absolutely key word to thinking about democratic or participatory forms of democracy, which is the idea of autonomy, and in particular, civil society autonomy. And for those who know your Gramsci, you'll know that for him, the key to democratization was what he called the march through the institutions, occupying the trenches of civil society. And Gramsci's work, and he wrote this sitting in the prison of the fascist Mussolini, he wrote this as part of his theory of hegemony and counter-hegemony. But I think the key to understanding Gramsci is precisely understanding the fact that for him, the hard work is in the trenches of civil society. And later on, he inspired a movement in Italy, a movement of theorists, also some radicals who were a little bit too radical at times. But it was a movement that called itself autonomia. And the interesting thing about the word autonomy is that if you spend time talking to Brazilian civil society activists and those who drove participatory democracy, if you talk to Aruna or Nikhil or civil society organizations in India, and increasingly, I suspect, now in the United States, the operative word in thinking about how we deepen democracy, especially under the threat of increasingly authoritarian governments, is this idea of the autonomy of civil society. And so Fox says the right to associational autonomy, which in principle is protected by the Constitution, but there's a big difference between having formal rights and being able to use those rights. The right to associational autonomy is constructed gradually and unevenly through cycles of conflicts that leave nascent democratic forces with political resources to draw on in successive rounds. Again, very much an iterative process. And then famously, Guillermo O'Donnell argues that if political democracy is to be consolidated, democratic practice needs to be spread throughout society, creating a rich fabric of democratic institutions and authorities. And the relevance of that will become clearer in a moment. So I want to give you what is a very minimalist definition of democracy, and then talk about democracy in the 21st century and make an argument that we need participatory democracy more than ever, and that this will be the century of participatory democracy. So the minimalist but classic definition or understanding of democracy for me is that it blocks the translation of social and economic power into political power. Now, I know that sounds a little, but if we think this through a little bit, I mean, the birth of modern Western parliamentary democracy, of course, comes as part of a long historical bourgeois revolution against feudalism, right? And the philosophical critique of feudalism, but also the pragmatic critique of feudalism, is that it allowed for the automatic translation of social and economic power, inherited, ascriptive wealth, et cetera, into political power, right? So the landlords were the political overlords as well. And even in 20th century conceptions of democracy, and in particular social democracy, the idea is that political power should not simply be a function of economic power, of property power, of capitalist power, et cetera. So one measure, one metric of how well democracy works would be the extent to which it blocks the translation of inherited social privilege, be it gender, race, ethnicity, religion, or the translation of economic power, property, capital, et cetera, into political power. Right? And we all know how easily those translate into political power, but can the mechanisms of democracy, the procedural rules of the game associated with a formal electoral democracy and all the complex dynamics of participatory democracy block those effects, right? And those effects are that much more pronounced today because we live in an era of globalization, right? And for those of you who've read Thomas Piketty, you know, the 1%, et cetera, the power of capital has gone completely global. It's beyond the control of nation states. And Adam Shavorsky, who is as mainstream a political scientist as you'll find, in one of his critiques of the contemporary era of globalization, says what we've discovered at the time he was talking about the people in Eastern Europe, but he could have easily said this of Brazil or India or now even the United States, that the people have learned that they can vote but that they can't choose, because the real decisions are being made not in parliaments, not even in the White House. The real decisions are being made in financial markets, are being made in the global circuits of capital by the 1%, et cetera. And by the way, I swear to God, this is the last time I'll ever mention Trump. He played on that, right? Quite successfully in his own bizarre, completely twisted way. In any event, so the 21st century developmental state. Peter Evans, a sociologist famous for developing, among others, a theory of the developmental state, the role that the state can play in accelerating processes of economic transformation and generally making an argument for the role of the state in development, has been toying with this idea that the 21st century developmental state has to be very different than the 20th century developmental state was. And the difference revolves around the fact that we're now in a completely new economy. Right? Danny Roderick recently has put the numbers together. The world has been deindustrializing very rapidly, right? I mean, we think of China as this industrial powerhouse. Only 25% of the Chinese workforce is in manufacturing. India has been deindustrializing since 2001. For the last 15 years, manufacturing and manufacturing jobs have been declining as a percentage of overall employment in India, right? So we're in a post-industrial era. And the new economy is an information economy. It's a knowledge-driven economy. It's a services economy. And among other things, Joe Stiglitz, the prominent Nobel Prize-winning economist, has said, development is no longer seen by economists as primarily a process of capital accumulation. So historically, that's what economists told us, that it's you've got to accumulate capital. Increasingly, economists recognize that it's a process of organizational change. And I'll say a little bit more about that in a moment. But I want to argue, following Peter Evans, that Stiglitz and Amartya Sen have something in common. Amartya Sen has famously been arguing that development isn't about per capita growth. Development is about enhancing people's capabilities, right? The capacity of people to make choices and to make the choices that they value. And in order to do those things, they have to have health, they have to have education, they have to have access, they have to be able to enter the public sphere, they have to be able to participate in political life. And he actually goes on to essentially make an argument for participatory democracy. All right, what's the relationship between all these things? Well, the new economy isn't so much about things and capital. The new economy is about ideas. It's about complex global. Think of how production is organized today. It used to be nation-based, more or less. You know, now everything is produced, your iPhones, everything is produced globally in these complex global integrated chains. So we have these integrated chains of delivery, and this is true for education, it's true for health. There isn't a sector today that doesn't involve some complex coordination of inputs. That's the new post-industrial economy. And this requires high-quality services. It requires a healthy population. It requires an educated population. It's not a coincidence that the best performers in the world, in any economic metric you want to use, are the social democracies, right? So if you take per capita productivity or per capita income, even if you discount oil in Norway, Finland, Sweden, Germany, of course, highest program. Why? Because they have massive investments in these services, in these institutional capabilities, in these abilities to link people together, to create innovation economies, to stimulate entrepreneurship, et cetera. And if we think this through, Nikhil raised the issue of sustainability. Increasingly today, we do recognize that there are very complex relationships between growth, between inclusion, between recognition, identity, and sustainability. And when we think about good governance, when we think about democratic governance, what we're thinking about essentially are systems that allow us to manage the tensions between growth and sustainability, between inclusion and growth, between issues of recognition and issues of redistribution. The third new dimension is that this is now a completely scaled world society and economy, that everything, ideas, economy, identities operate at multiple levels, the global level, a national level, and increasingly a subnational level, right? Cities play, and the subnational plays a more important role in the global economy today than it's ever played. But the key is being able to manage to negotiate the relationships between the different scales, right? And Brexit, you know, is unfortunately an example of how that process of negotiating the relationship between Britain and the EU became so complicated that some opted out, et cetera. But almost everyone who can step back and think about it thinks, well, that's probably going to be a mistake. You don't want to opt out. You want to figure out how to manage your relationship to that larger scale. So all of this really, if you think this through, and this isn't a particularly dramatic conclusion, but you know, if you look at the history of capitalist states, they've been getting bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger, right? So you know, the neoliberals notwithstanding, the state as a percentage of the economy has been growing inexorably for over a century and a half. And there's a good reason for that, because the more sophisticated, the more complex, the more scaled your economy and your society, the more you need coordination. And markets do not provide coordination. Markets generate profits, they generate entrepreneurship. They do not secure coordination between these different sectoral demands and between the scales. The answer to all of these problems used to be bureaucracy, right? That's the sort of traditional Weberian. You know, you get a bunch of formal rules and formal bureaucrats to enforce this, but bureaucracies are too inflexible to really manage all of this complexity. So all of this is to say that we need forms of the state that are more embedded, that have more ties to different actors, where there's more intelligence, continuous monitoring and feedback and co-production. There's actually a huge literature that's emerged on the EU. And you know, the EU today gets all sorts of criticism. It's too bureaucratic, et cetera. But if you actually look at the literature, the EU is not that bureaucratic. There's a tremendous amount of engagement between the EU bureaucracy and various organized civil society actors. And internally, there's a lot of horizontal learning across EU bureaucracies. There's a lot of feedback mechanisms, peer reviews, et cetera. It's not your traditional hierarchical system at all. There's tremendous amount of learning and experimentation in the EU. So you need these more flexible, these more adaptive systems of governance. And then one last point that I want to make, and this is particularly true in the global south, less so in the global north, but of course the state building process is much newer in the global south, and that's the last mile problem. That the capacity of the state to do all these complex things, provide integrated transport systems, manage public housing, ensure that cities have all the services and that these are well coordinated, provide for an educational system that's flexible and inclusive, et cetera. All this depends on obviously good policies, but it also requires really good frontline workers. You need good teachers, good engineers, good planners, good lawyers, good accountants, et cetera. And this last mile problem is especially acute in much of the developing world. And I'll say a little bit more about that in a moment. So for me, and I'm not the one saying this, Danny Roderick, Amartya Sen, many others are now arguing that given this need for these incredibly flexible, connected systems of governance, we need participatory democracy more than ever, because traditional representative bureaucracy, it's kind of slow, the accountability mechanisms are poor, it tends to be very bureaucratic and top-down, whereas participatory democracy is much more flexible, is much more intelligent in terms of the kinds of inputs you get into the system. And so many are arguing that the meta-institution of the 21st century should be some form of participatory democracy. So very briefly then, and this comes back to the point that John was making in his presentation this morning. You know, and here I just want to be clear about how we use our terms, because a lot of questions have come up, how are we defining democracy, et cetera. So one, this is the conventional political economy definition of extending democracy, right? Substantive democracy, as it's been called in the literature. And that's moving along this axis of going from a minimalist form of democracy, the liberal state, the traditional Anglo-Saxon expression of democracy, which is essentially enforcing civil and political rights, and then the state has these sort of minimalist night watchman functions, as Adam Smith called them, of supporting the market and providing a few public goods, national security, et cetera. But that's pretty much the limit of it, right? So it's a very limited form of democracy. It's a form of democracy that has power over a very limited realm of social and economic activity. Social democracy, or if you will, the social developmental state, I won't get into the terminology, but the point is that here you've now expanded the reach and the authority of democracy. So democracy doesn't just regulate individual rights and property rights. Democracy might also enforce socioeconomic rights. It might also enforce the rights of women in the private bourgeois household. It might also defend the rights of minorities, et cetera. This is a significant expansion in the power of democracy, the realm of things over which it is the people's voice, however well it's been expressed, actually managing the affairs of economy, society, and community, right? So, but this is fairly conventional. I want to add the participatory democracy dimension, and I call participatory democracy it's not an extension of the power of democracy, it's a deepening of who's involved and how they're involved, right? And this question came up in the earliest session. And so we normally think of a minimalist form of democracy in process terms as simple representation. Every 4 years, you go to the polls, you vote, and then you sort of forget about it, and you hope and pray that the people that you've delegated to govern for you are going to do a good job, right? Pretty blunt mechanism of accountability. I think most people agree that this comes with serious, obvious problems and deficits. Hence the argument for more continuous forms of democratic input. Which isn't to say, and I want to be absolutely clear about this, if it isn't representative, it's not democracy, right? The idea of participatory democracy is not to replace representative mechanisms and delegation. In any large complex society, I love to deliberate. I wrote a book on deliberation. I'm a professor. This is what we do. We all deliberate. You know, you can't deliberate all the time, right? I mean, George Orwell once said, socialism is impossible because people don't want to be at meetings all the time. Well, maybe they want to be at some more meetings. But so at some point you have to, you know, close the discussion and you need a decision-making mechanism. So we're always going to have some form of voting or some form of delegation and representation. The question is, before we vote, before we elect representatives, before we go and vote against England belonging to the European Union, could we at least have a participatory moment of genuine conversation, discussion with some structures that facilitate that participation? Same with budgeting at the panchayat level or at the city level, et cetera. So I would argue that there's really two dimensions of deepening, if you will, democracy. One is expanding what I call the surface area and quality of engagement with the state. And this is more relevant to the global south, to the global north, but it's as a general rule, I think this is an incredibly important point. Most Indian citizens can't find the goddamn state. And when they do, it takes the form of petty corruption or an abusive police officer or a bureaucrat who won't pay attention. So the state is A, hard to find, and two, very difficult to engage with, right? And this is a general problem throughout the new democracies, relatively new, of the global south. But even in the first world, this is an obvious problem. So expanding the surface area of the state, the points of contact with the state, to me is one of the critical parts of thinking about participatory democracy. The other point, and this came up, obviously, is just broadening the range of social groups that are actually engaged in the process of governance beyond the traditional elites or the groups that simply shout the loudest or are best at self-representing themselves. So then you can combine the two, and you get a nice little table, and I'll fill it out. But if we think of India or Anglo-Saxon democracies, you know, they don't have a tremendous amount of power. There's a whole range of economic activities where they don't intervene very proactively. You know, this is generally what we now call sort of the neoliberal democracies. They sort of limit the democratic authority to a few well-defined realms, but otherwise let the market do its thing, and there's minimalist intervention. And so they're representative, but they're not terribly participatory, right? In the United States, I mean, there's local government, et cetera, but it doesn't have participatory structures, at least not in the sense of some of these other cases. And in India, the MKSS, in the case of Kerala, which I'll talk about in a moment, may be exceptions, but for the most part, it's difficult in India to participate. There are liberal democracies that are a little bit more participatory. I'm from Switzerland, and you know the communes in Switzerland, we go to meetings all the time, and there's actually a lot of stuff you can do locally. You run your own schools, you run your own water systems. The local democratic structures are quite accessible. They're very nearby, they're very small, they're very immediate. On the other hand, at the national level, Switzerland is still very much dominated by banks and corporate interests, et cetera, and the power of the state in other sectors is quite limited. The other famous example that de Tocqueville gave us was America's town halls, right? So, you know, white men with property at least get to deliberate. It's exclusionary, but it's not just representative. But again, it's limited. They can't do land reform. They're not going to structure labor markets, et cetera. Unfortunately, that does not exhaust the universe of democracies. There are others. I think South Africa, and I'll talk a lot more about South Africa, but South Africa, everyone keeps calling it neoliberal, but post-apartheid South Africa has actually significantly increased social spending. It has rolled out services. It's been much more proactive in forcing its socioeconomic agenda. So it's gone way beyond a liberal democracy. And then France famously has always had a very powerful central state. I mean, the state in France is so powerful in regulating labor markets that there are no more unions. The unions stopped unionizing because the state does it for them, for all intents and purposes. And so it's quite, you know, they have universal health care, the fairly generous welfare state apparatus, but not the least bit participatory, right? Not very decentralized, incredibly technocratic. The political class in France is probably the most refined modern caste in the world, right? They all went to the same schools, they all marry each other, they go back and forth between the banks and government. I mean, it's a tightly knit group, you know, and it's very difficult to really access the political system in France. So more social democratic, less participatory. Finally, we're getting to the cases that we're most interested in. I'll talk about Kerala and Brazil in a moment. Just very briefly on the Nordic social democracies. You know, we tend to think of them as these big bureaucratic welfare states, and they are big. 60%+ of the economy is usually in the public sector. They're actually not that bureaucratic. If you look at the fiscal numbers in Scandinavia, most social expenditure is at the local level. And they have the highest density of civil society organizations in the advanced democratic world. Unionization rates are incredibly high. I heard Tom, I think, say that their standards of transparency are amongst some of the best in the world. It doesn't mean that they're perfect. There are excluded categories. And there's now a reaction, unfortunately, to the refugee crisis in Europe. But by and large, Scandinavian social democracies have delivered on extending democracy into the economic realm and securing socioeconomic rights. And they've done so in a fairly participatory manner. Right? Now, is this being challenged? Is it reversible? Of course it is. But it stands out as a model. I want to move on now to, you saw this table earlier, so I'm not going to say much about it. just to remind you, the arrows got flipped somehow, but it's not a big deal. That the democratic process, if we think about it, is a chain of sovereignty, right? The people speak, maybe imperfectly, but they speak. Representatives are supposed to then implement, right? And throughout that chain, all sorts of things can go wrong, right? So the speaking part, the thinking, can be problematic. How are preferences actually formed? Why did the British vote against Brexit? Did they really have good information? Do American voters really think that Donald Trump can bring steel manufacturing back to Pittsburgh? You know, it's not going to happen, et cetera. But in any event, there's a process of deliberation that's more or less rich and inclusive and effective, or not, as it were. Then there's the election itself, or mechanisms of representation, the aggregative moment. And then there's the delivery moment, right? Because you can send the guys and the women, whatever, to Washington, D.C., but will they actually deliver on their promises? And the argument then is, in order for this to work relatively well, and it never works perfectly, obviously, you need all these different domains of participation, which at every step of the process throughout the chain of sovereignty can ensure that the democratic process is actually respected. All right, so I've said this before. I'm going to skip this and get to cases. Obviously, there are a lot of challenges, and this is just repeating things that have been said today. Participation. The best example of participation in the United States in recent times is the Tea Party, a grassroots mobilization that captured local government, infiltrated the establishment Republican Party, transformed the nature of that party. Yes, it got money from the outside and the Koch brothers, but it's first and foremost a grassroots movement. We may not like it, but it's participatory. So there's always the empirical question of who's actually using these participatory spaces. In India, in urban India, as John was saying, oftentimes it's middle class groups, it's not the slums, et cetera. So this is an empirical question. The vertical question I've already talked about, and then the scales. At what scale is participation actually happening? So let me come to my cases. So I'm going to, how much time do I have, John?
You have 15 minutes.
Oh, 15 minutes. So I've got 5 minutes for three continents. but all I really want to do is sort of highlight some differences, make us think maybe a little bit more comparatively about these questions, and then focus on a few lessons, and then we'll just open it up to discussion. The only point, IBSA, India, Brazil, and South Africa. I think these are really interesting cases because these are democracies that came out of very vibrant civil society movements, the anti-apartheid movement, the pro-democracy movement in Brazil, the Indian National Congress in India. So quite rich structures on the ground. These are democracies that should have never happened. If you look at the political science literature, you're never supposed to get a democracy when you have deep inequalities, and yet these are democracies that have been consolidated and have largely survived despite intense inequalities of race, caste, income, et cetera. One feature of these democracies that doesn't get commented on enough, although I don't have to tell Nikhil and Aruna and Indian activists about this, but I think it needs to be highlighted, is that for all the achievements of Indian democracy at the local level, and this is true of Brazil and South Africa as well, at least until recently, there's no democracy at the local level. At the local level, it's what Mamdani, the famous African theorist, calls decentralized despotism, right? I mean, there are very few actual mechanisms of accountability. I recently finished a project on Indian cities. All the mobilizations that we've been talking about, MKSS, NREGA, Panchayati Raj, which I'll mention briefly in a moment, these are all examples of rural India. When you look at urban India, it's even less democratic. Right. I spent months in large slums in Delhi where no one's ever seen the state. Now, the state shows up to take some bribes, et cetera, but the idea that you actually engage with the state is unthinkable. The middle class groups figure out how to do it, yeah. But the urban poor, and this is going to be a huge issue moving forward. So those are some of the challenges. So India in general, and again, you should never say anything about India, period. All generalizations for India are false by definition. And I'm about to give you a counterexample. But if I had to generalize about India, the obstacles to participation are obvious. There's very durable inequalities of gender and caste. Having said that, that has never stopped Dalits or other subaltern groups from mobilizing and organizing. So this argument that you can't have participation in an unequal society is empirically kind of problematic. I think we need to be reminded that in any democracy, as hard as participation is, it's the one comparative advantage the poor have. They don't have money by definition. They don't have networks, political connections, at least not to the degree that elites do. But they do have the capacity to participate, as long as their basic civic and political rights are being respected. And by and large, with the possible exception of the current regime in India, that's generally the case. The state in India is it's hard to find, and it's also very insular. Right? The frontline bureaucracy is not particularly receptive. I've never understood why the people in charge of slum redevelopment in Delhi are all engineers. I mean, engineers do not know how to redevelop a slum. Redeveloping a slum is not an engineering task, it's a social task, right? But there's this idea that you can do it technocratically, et cetera, and of course it's false, but it means that the frontline bureaucracy is rarely very responsive to the average citizen and makes it difficult for people to citizenize, whatever that word is. As I said already, the surface area of the state is quite limited. Another point I want to emphasize, and this is a very uncomfortable point, and Nikhil asked a question about the relationship between representative and participatory democracy. Another way of putting it is the relationship between parties and civil society. And it's a very tense relationship, and it's a very difficult relationship. And political parties in India, in part because of the terms under which democracy came to India, et cetera, but they have, for the most part, not all of them, but been quite hostile to civil society. And now we're seeing it, of course, institutionalized in the current regime. Modi's regime has been extremely aggressive and hostile towards civil society. But in general, parties have had a very difficult relationship with civil society. Unions are the best example. India's unions are not really independent unions. They tend to be tied to political parties. And if you want to make any advances as a union, you need to align yourself with a political party. And that in and of itself would be fine, except for, as we discussed this morning, the iron law of oligarchy. I mean, political parties mobilize resources. They're quite good at hoarding resources. The black economy in India has been a huge source of electoral funds for political parties. And one of the things that always strikes me about political parties in India today is that they're all doing land deals, right? They're all implicated in urban land deals because that's how you fund your political campaigns. And so when community groups, when the slums, when affected groups protest against land deals, they've got no political party to go to because they all have a stake in this rent-sharing land deal system. So I do think that's a major problem with some important exceptions. Very briefly, I want to tell you, and there's others in this room who can tell you a lot more about the Kerala story. For those of you not familiar with India, Kerala is a state in the southwest of India, 31 million people, size of California, so this is not a small story. In 1996, the CPM, a communist party, and you usually don't think of communist parties as favoring decentralization, right? Because Leninism, decentralization doesn't really go together. But in any event, the CPM comes to power in 96, and building in part on national developments and new constitutional amendments at the national level, they say, all right, it's time to decentralize. We've done a pretty good job as a state, and it's true, Kerala's social development indicators are the best in India, but we've got complexity problems at the local level, and we need to devolve power to a local community. So 990 panchayats in Kerala get 35% of the budget, which is unheard of in India. The average is usually below 1%. So all of a sudden, these local, democratically elected village governments, panchayats, get all this money and a mandate to do participatory planning, right? So they have to go through this mandated exercise of involving people, putting together a plan, allocating monies, and essentially doing a budget, not unlike Porto Alegre. And it works relatively well, in part because Kerala is incredibly competitive, right? So the Communist Party competes with the Congress, so it's a vibrant political setting. You had a very mobilized civil society, and you had a phenomenon very similar to the MKSS in the sense that a key NGO, a grassroots group called the KSSP, mass membership, mostly teachers in rural areas, and I got into a lot of trouble in Kerala for saying this once, but I'll say it again, what the hell. They infiltrated the CPM. They literally infiltrated the CPM, and they brought this idea of participation into what was a Leninist political party, right? And there was some pushback, et cetera, but fortunately, the intellectual leader of the party, a guy named EMS Nambudiripad, had been advocating decentralization for 40 years, and so he gave them some cover, and they were able to do this. And they've had two extraordinary achievements. One is they've moved the state they've actually gone from having one unitary state of Kerala to having 990 local governments, which is not easy to do. And in doing so, they've increased the surface area of engagement. And so simple, I just want to give you a super simple example, right? There's a lot of new things that are being done at the local area. But when you want a birth certificate now, and you take birth certificate, that's pretty straightforward, right? In India, you can't survive without you need lots of IDs, you need lots of paper, right? And you need a birth certificate for all sorts of things. Usually you had to go to the district level to get a birth certificate. Now you go to the local panchayat office and you get your birth certificate in 24 hours, right? So literally stateness has improved. The state is there, and it's allowed for better local planning, a better integration of transportation and education, a lot of stuff around agriculture, et cetera. There have been problems. You know, you can't mobilize people forever, and there's been a certain amount of demobilization. Although they have remobilized through women's self-help groups, a famous program called Kudumbashree, there's been a lot of bureaucratization. You know, I mean, the Indian state likes paperwork, and inevitably some of that process has filtered down to the local level, and there's a certain amount of bureaucratization. But in general, though, there's far greater ability to participate on a daily basis in public life, in local decision making, than was the case just 20 years ago. I'm going to be very brief with South Africa. South Africa is the cautionary story. In some ways, South Africa was better poised to build a participatory democracy than any society transitioning into democracy ever, and for three reasons. One, highly mobilized civil society, the civics, the unions, the UDF, the churches, really well organized, internally democratic, very powerful. Two, you had a left of center political party, the African National Congress, that was closely aligned with these movements and that advocated in the constitution of a form of participatory democracy. It's all laid out, it's very clearly spelled out. And you had some local state capacity. So this is not so true in rural areas, but in the cities of South Africa, you have tremendous capacity. South African cities are actually, you know, in terms of basic services and having local bureaucracy and financial systems, they're quite strong by Global South standards. So you really had everything you needed for a successful transition to participatory democracy. But, and this is where the tension with political parties comes into play. The ANC, people forget this, but the leadership of the ANC was the exile faction. So the Mbekis and the Zumas and the guys who run the party, these guys were not in South Africa during the struggle. They were wanted and being hunted down by the apartheid state. And unfortunately, some of them went to East Germany for training, which in retrospect was probably not a good idea. But in any event, they come back and they have a very technocratic Leninist vision of transformation. We have the state, we have power, 66% of the population votes for us. We know how to get it done. It's called the NDR, the National Democratic Revolution, you know, and they produce all these papers and programs, et cetera. And all this mobilized civil society stuff to them is just noise. It gets in the way. And plus they start challenging. We heard about Mbeki, you know, Mbeki said, HIV doesn't cause AIDS, it's about poverty, it's tuberculosis, it's a Western imperial conspiracy, we're not going to treat it. And the Treatment Action Campaign contested that, and they came under tremendous pressure from the ANC. Violence, intimidation, and that was generally true of civil society. So you had this demobilization of civil society. All these local participatory structures were dismantled, the community development forums, the IDPs, I could go on and on. You get a lot of delivery. I mean, they do deliver sewage and they do build some schools and health clinics, but without participation. And you'll say, so what? All right, maybe who cares? No, they didn't participate, but they delivered. The problem is the stuff they delivered is not very good, in part because there's very little accountability of these systems. And two, it's ended up triggering an urban revolt. For the last 10 years, South Africa, on a daily basis, there are so-called service delivery protests. And this is people protesting what they call service delivery, and it turns out the issue has less to do with services than with dignity. And the sense that the party is no longer the party of the people, it's, as they like to say in South Africa, they're now on the gravy train, they don't take the masses seriously anymore. And this very recently, if you've been following the news in South Africa, literally in the last 3 months, two dramatic things have happened. So one, for the first time ever, the ANC has lost elections. The Party of National Liberation, the Party of Mandela, lost Johannesburg, Pretoria, East Port Elizabeth, and already lost Cape Town. So they've lost the biggest cities, right, to a party that basically came out, you know, the old apartheid era party, et cetera. And secondly, Zuma is probably on his way out, in part because the corruption has become so endemic that there's just tremendous opposition to the ANC. So for me, this is a cautionary tale of, A, how difficult it is to build participatory democracy, but the dangers of not building a participatory democracy when you have a highly mobilized civil society. And this excluded, marginalized civil society has essentially come back to bite them very hard. So finally, this is probably the best known example of a relatively successful instance of moving at least in the direction of participatory democracy. There's been, as you all know, a significant reversal of late with a constitutional coup at the national level. But to me, that only demonstrates just how far these processes went and how threatening they were to entrenched elites. And all I want to do is highlight the contrast with South Africa here. Namely that, like South Africa, you have a vibrant civil society, a long, protracted pro-democracy movement. It eventually produces a constitution that has built, the word participatory runs right through the entire Brazilian constitution. And there's all sorts of very specific structures that are created at the local level. The most famous is participatory budgeting, 410 cities now do it. Something that gets talked about less, but I think is even more important, which is this idea of council democracy. None of the monies devolved from the center for health, for transport, for school, for youth, get transferred until a local council, which is constituted of civil society groups, approves the local budgetary allocation, right? So civil society groups have binding authority over the allocation of federal monies. There's the city statute, a famous piece of legislation that mandates participatory planning at the city level. So all of these things have created new spaces. And the key here is that it's allowed ordinary citizens, NGOs, community groups, unions to engage with the state and do so as bearers of rights, not as clients of the state, not as clients of politicians. So there's been a rupture with the traditional politics of clientelism. And from a developmental point of view, what's really interesting is the new forms of co-production, which goes to the argument I was making about the 21st century development to say, how do you deliver health services and education in a modern, complex, globalizing economy? You work with teachers, right? Or you work with doctors and you work with nurses. And a lot of the institutional reforms in Brazil, including formalizing informal labor markets, where they probably made the most progress of all, have all been done with alliances between state actors and their civil society counterparts. The Ministerio Público, which is the prosecutor's office, it's full of lawyers, upper class, mostly white lawyers. They call themselves lawyers for civil society because they go out there and they look for class action lawsuits against the state. And they sue the state for environmental issues, not enforcing labor standards, et cetera. So that's what I mean by co-production. And there's a ton of that in Brazil today. And it's largely a result of this history of civil society movements engaging the state. And here, just a really quick metric. And I'm almost out of time, and I just want to put up my last slide. But there's a direct relationship between the degree of participation and the size of the local social developmental state, which is really, really interesting, right? So this is just health staff, education, social assistance staff. The intensities are the intensity of participation. So in cities, there's low intensity participation cities going to high intensity participation cities. And what you see in these numbers, and it's really clear, you don't need a regression coefficient for this, the more the participation, the larger the size of the local social state. And I will finish by just running you, do I have 2 minutes? 1 minute.
Not really. Take two.
No, I'll take two. So I just want to say, when we think about the challenges of participatory democracy, I think we need to be fully aware of the tensions between political and civil society. You know, ideally they work together, as in the PT in the early years, it was a social movement party. Now it's in total conflict because the PT has become corrupt or too close to power, et cetera. But this is always a problematic relationship. Openings from above, whether it's the National Advisory Committee or it's the reformists in the state government of Kerala who were critical in making the campaign work, or ministers from the Sanatarista movement in the health ministries in Brazil, you've got to have some reformers that give you access to the state, right? And that's a really critical condition. I've already made the argument about embeddedness. I just want to emphasize that, unlike the anarchists, we should engage with the state. You want to blur those state-civil society relations, but not at the expense of your autonomy, right? Once you lose your autonomy, you've been co-opted, you become part of the state project, et cetera. And then finally, and this goes straight to all of the extraordinary work that MKSS has done, but also the campaign in Kerala, you know, one of the keys to this is really boring, but it's institutional design. It's that painstaking work of experimenting, playing around, bootstrapping, figuring out what works. What are the mechanisms that allow for citizens to effectively engage with local government? It's the learning by doing, et cetera. And to take a long-term view, especially in light of the events of the last 2 weeks, I think what we need more than anything is a politics of patience and that hard pushing that, I forget the Greek, the metaphor with pushing that rock. We may need Sisyphuses. What's the plural of Sisyphus? Anyways, and it's a politics of patience. It's hard work. It's a lot of pushing. But at the end of the day, it's about what you do in the trenches of civil society. And that's my take on participatory democracy.
Patrick, thank you. That was absolutely amazing. There's an extraordinary amount of ground, so many ideas there. I have quite a few questions myself, but I think I should probably invite others to speak first. Please.
Thank you very much. I'm sorry,
the light's bright, I can barely see who's okay.
I can move?
No, it's okay.
Okay. So you started out by defining for us what globalization has meant and what this new economy looks like, which is mainly knowledge-based and information-based technologies and knowledge economy. And I think that, for me, what the most important part of our new economy is financialization, which has increased tremendously. And from whatever I read, it is estimated that in the world, there are 1.4 billion people involved in labor and 2.4 billion who are unemployed, who've been driven from their land. It's a question of, you know, in David Harvey's term, primitive accumulation, and you're not creating any value, so you really want, you know. So in that scenario, does that change any of the things that you're talking about in terms of democracy? Because we are looking at really very grave situation when you have so many, you know, a third of the world's population who's going to be dispossessed and without any prospect of jobs. Thanks.
Why don't we come around here? And perhaps you'll avoid that light. Yes. On your kind of, when did you last see your father?
Or what happened 2 weeks ago?
Yes.
I'm here.
Take that. Five? Okay.
Yeah, well, global finance is the sort of 900-pound gorilla in this story, and obviously a problem. All I can really say is, one, we should put it in historical perspective. So for those of you who haven't had the joy and pleasure of reading Piketty's 700-page treatise on this.
Thanks.
I'll summarize it very quickly. I mean, the data in it is extraordinary. It's a global inequality, right? Very nicely measured. None of the economists can test the measures. And the most unequal moment in recent history was the 1870s. And we're now almost back to where we were. But the important thing to remember is what happened to that extraordinary inequality of the 1870s. And by the way, capital at the time was very global as well, because the elites bought bonds and they built railroads in India and all over the world, the Suez Canal, et cetera. And there's actually some people who claim that the degree of global financialization was almost as advanced in the 1870s. Who knows? But yeah, the inequality was extreme, there's no doubt. And these were all rentiers, just as they are today. Back then they had bonds from government, today they have stocks and more complex instruments, but it's the same idea. They And the interesting thing that happened, of course, was the Polanyi moment, right? The counter movement, two world wars as well. I shouldn't forget that. But Piketty, who's not he's an economist, he's not a sociologist, but he says the key to creating a less unequal society was the rise of the welfare state, the mobilization of the working class, organization, in a word, participation, right? And a lot of it was a reaction to the stark inequalities of the 1870s. So that's not predictive of what's going to happen now, but, I'd like to think that if there's going to be a response to find, look, again, I promised I wouldn't mention Trump again, but the two good things about Trump, good is, maybe, anyways, could have, I'll bracket that word. But the two important things about Trump is he popularized two words that have never been spoken in American public discourse. One is the working class. So I used to work for unions in California. I used to do their political propaganda. I wasn't allowed to use the word working class. You said working families or middle class. Everyone's middle class in the US, or I'm sure it's the same thing in Canada. So there's no work. Now all of a sudden we've discovered a working class. I mean, Bernie helped. Bernie was a big part of it, but Trump came along, and that's good because it implies the category that you're talking about. We've rediscovered that category. And the other key word that wasn't part of the American vocabulary for it was globalization. I mean, globalization before was just something that was happening. Now it's been problematized, and we're back to what will the response be? Will it be barbarism or socialism? Will it be closure or social democracy and social and global solidarity? And I actually think that despite Trump and despite Modi, and again, I come back to what's happened to Latin America in the last 30 years, the jury is still out on what the response is going to be.
There's nobody else. Perhaps I can just throw in my question then, or one of my questions. I mean, I think pretty much sort of central to your argument, to the ideas about, as you put it, increasing the surface area and quality of engagement with the state, and broadening the range of social groups engaged. And in Kerala and in Brazil, there have been experiences of that increasing surface area, broadening the range of social groups engaged. But surely, I mean, that came about as a result of prior political mobilizations. So, in a way, I'm sort of still wondering where do you see the mobilizations coming from? Certainly in Kerala, a long history of local organization and of popular mobilizations. And, nothing like as long in the case of the PT in Brazil, but a fair bit of history before we get to Porto Alegre and participatory budget and so on.
Yeah, and this goes back to the introductory quotes, especially right. The one from Scotchpole, that these are iterative struggles that develop over time, et cetera. And hence my closing with, it's actually a line I borrowed from Arjuna Paduri, A Politics of Patience. I mean, on the left, I think we've always been enamored of a politics of rupture, which almost inevitably invites almost Leninist visions of transformation. The ANC is going to get it all done, and you just have to be scientific and very Marxist about it, and good stuff will happen. And I do think these are cumulative processes, but if you had said in the 1940s or 50s that Kerala would be a paragon of democratic deepening, you would have been called insane. It was the most conflicted state in India, emergency rule, tremendous conflict, strikes, and lots of caste atrocities, et cetera. I mean, it was, and it's that conflict that eventually drove the mobilizations. Similarly, in Brazil, if you read the political science literature from the early 90s, which I should be careful because now it almost seems prophetic. But anyways, in the early 90s, all the top Brazilian political scientists were saying democracy will never work in Brazil. And the reason was the generals. Yeah. And we haven't heard from the generals in 30 years. I mean, the generals are out of the picture, and the constitution's robust, and there's been a bit of a reaction now, a lot of a reaction. But and so, again, these things actually happened. In retrospect, it seems like they took a long time, but at the time, it was difficult to detect what was going to happen. So, yes, I do think it takes mobilization. Where it comes from, who saw the Tea Party coming, right? It's the hardest thing to predict are social movements, but they do happen very quickly at times.
Please. I think this has to, because I was told 5 minutes only about 5 minutes ago. So
well,
please
this
go.
Is a very, very naive question, but listening to what Anna Gabrielle was saying today, is it perhaps that our view but of how democracy evolves is inbred in conflict, but maybe there are other forms of democracy which are not necessarily bred from conflict, and that's certainly what Alan was talking about today. I'm just wondering whether our view
right.
of what mm-hmm. advances democracy is actually mm-hmm. perhaps very much Anglo-Saxon or very much detached from other forms of advanced democracies, and that's just a very...
No, but I think it's a critically...
So
to simplify the history of democracy from Native Americans to the Lakota in Namibia to thousands of traditions across the world, deliberative democracy has a long, long history. Communities coming together, deliberating in an inclusive fashion. I mean, we have to be slightly careful to not overly romanticize. I mean, how inclusive was it, et cetera. But the idea of an inclusive deliberative democracy predates European civilization and colonialism, et cetera. The radical idea is James Manbridge's point of Westminster representative democracy, because it is adversarial by definition, right? Mm-hmm. You've got competing political parties,
yep.
and the returns to victory are enormous. You know, all the gains go to the winner, et cetera, et cetera. That's a radical rupture. The question is, you know, can you replicate community-based, inclusive, deliberative democracy at the level of the EU? Look at the Indian democratic experiment. We can poke fun at democracy and criticize it, but if nothing else, democracy helped bring India together. I mean, without democracy, India,
yeah.
I think of Bangladesh or Pakistan or civil war in Sri Lanka, right? I mean, so it's imperfect, we all understand that, but it did allow for most groups to have at least a voice, which didn't preclude exclusion, but why is it all Indians vote? And the more poor you are, the lower caste you are. Muslims in India, despite what's happened in the last 20 years, still keep voting. And part of it is a politics of dignity, but part of it is the recognition that those minimal civic and political rights are really important. They're not enough. And they're adversarial, there's no doubt. And then the question is, how can we reconcile, you know, more participatory, deliberative mechanisms and institutions with the inherently adversarial, conflictual nature of a modern, complex democratic society.
Patrick, thank you very much. I understand we have to formally call to a close at this point, but thanks very much.
Yeah, thank you, and I apologize.